The title of my talk is Radical Distinctiveness as Both the Call and the Fruit of the True Gospel. Radical Distinctiveness as Both the Call and the Fruit of the True Gospel. Along with the subtitle from Chris Wright's talk and the wording also from the Cape Town Commitment, Section 2E, calling the Church of Christ back to humility, integrity, and simplicity. There's one key word that stands out from this section of the Cape Town Commitment, and that is the word distinctiveness. Walk in distinctiveness as God's new humanity. That section of the Cape Town Commitment goes on to read, since there is no biblical mission without biblical living, we urgently recommit ourselves and challenge all those who profess the name of Christ to live in radical distinctiveness from the ways of the world, to put on the new humanity created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. The gospel call to a radical distinctiveness of the church from the world. In other words, gospel-empowered biblical living. And it's also a radical distinctiveness of the church for the world. In other words, a gospel-bearing and demonstrating biblical mission. To help guide and frame our time today, I want to have us look together at Romans chapter 12 to help focus our hearts and minds. I'm going to invite James from Bangladesh to come read the passage, all of Romans 12, for us. Japan is the second largest unreached people group in the world, and we're very thankful to the Lausanne movement for the focus that it has given to the global church on unreached people groups. What's number one? Bangladesh is number one largest unreached people group in the world. So on this stage, we'll represent the largest and second largest unreached people group in the world and ask for your prayers that will change.
Thank you. Thank you. That is just, may we read Romans chapter 12. Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. For by the grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment, in accordance with the faith God has distributed to each of you. For just as each of us has one body with many members, and these members do not all have the same functions, so in Christ we, though many, form one body, and each member belongs to all the others. We have different gifts according to the grace given to each of us. If your gift is prophesying, then prophesy in accordance with your faith. If it is serving, then serve. If it is teaching, then teach. If it is to encourage, then give encouragement. If it is giving, then give generously. If it is to lead, do it diligently. If it is to show mercy, do it cheerfully. Love in action. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are indeed practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge. I will repay, say the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed them. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So thank you, Brother Michael. Thank
you. Go ahead and be seated. So radical distinctiveness. Paul in Romans 12 begins to flesh out what radical distinctiveness looks like. Radical distinctiveness of the church from the world and for the world. Paul roots radical distinctiveness in the mercy of the gospel, verse 1. Therefore, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, the radical distinctiveness that flows from the mercy of God, the mercy and the glory of the gospel of Jesus Christ, as beautifully and powerfully expressed in the first 11 chapters of Romans. The word mercy communicates both the forgiveness of sinners who are guilty and also the tender-hearted compassion of God towards us in our helpless and desperate state. The chapters leading up to chapter 12 of Romans gush with floods of mercy. A few years ago, there was a discovery of a new river here in Brazil, the Rio Hamza. And the Rio Hamza is actually 4 kilometers underneath the Amazon River. So the Amazon River, I think, is like 6,000-7,000 kilometers in space. And the Rio Hamza actually flows underneath it, 4 kilometers down. And it is just as long as the Amazon River, but at certain spaces, in certain places, it actually is hundreds, even hundreds of times wider than the Amazon River. So there's this massive underground river with a massive flow of water. And Romans, similarly, gushes with floods of divine mercy. The flow, that flow beneath the surface that is at the core of God's work in our innermost being, and also that empowers the visible elements of radical distinctiveness in the Christian life. Chapter 3, God credits us righteousness. He offers us justification and redemption. Jesus' blood propitiates the wrath of God. Chapter 4, our transgressions are forgiven and our sins are covered. Our sins are not counted against us. God gives us spiritual life. He gives spiritual life to the spiritually dead. Romans 5, God poured out his love into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Verse 9, we have been saved from God's wrath. God grants us eternal life and peace with God and joy from him, even in the midst of suffering. Romans 6, God grants us death unto sin and new life. Chapter 7, the bearing of fruit. Chapter 8, freedom from condemnation. Adoption as his children, we are made heirs of God, co-heirs with Christ. God shares his glory with you, Christian. He conforms us to his likeness. God provides his love from which we can never be separated. Chapter 10, God calls, God saves all who call on him. He allows those who do not seek him to find him. Chapter 11, God offers us his kindness. Mercy, mercy, mercy. The Greek word here for mercy is rightly plural. It is manifold, abundant mercies. And then from mercy flows everything else, starting with the call to sacrifice. Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. A fine description of radically distinct biblical living unto God. It's a glad affirmation in response to 1 Corinthians 6, you are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body. It is a right response of one who has been redeemed and redeemed at the very dear price of the blood of Jesus Christ. As we read in 1 Peter 1, we were redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. And we also see in the next phrase, the connecting piece between our offering and our worship. The great that great worship is not just about an excellent praise band, but it's about the beauty of mercy responsive whole body and life consecration and sacrifice to God. Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Verse 2, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Do not conform. This is radical distinctiveness, non-conformity. In view of God's mercy, do not conform. That word conform is used only one other time in the New Testament, in 1 Peter 1:14. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. Peter then goes on to say, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Do not conform, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Transformation via mind renewal. Mind renewal in the truth and the power of the Word of God. I think this verse alone is biblical proof that how we think is extremely practical, that the mind matters, and that truth impacts living. So radical distinctiveness in biblical living requires radical distinctiveness in biblical thinking. This word transformed occurs only three other times in the New Testament in describing Jesus' transfiguration and also our being transformed into Christ's likeness with ever-increasing glory. And the transformation comes by the renewing of our minds. This is radical work. The only other time this word renewing is used is in Titus 3:5, where it describes our salvation by Christ through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. And this radical work can help empower radically distinct ways of thinking, radically distinct from the world, as distinct as God's ways and will are distinct from this world. But where we lack, and when we lack in our understanding and appreciation of God's will and word and ways, and fail to understand or be floored by the mercies of God, both our thinking and our lives will lack distinctiveness from the world and unto God. When we don't know God's word, our minds fail to be renewed as they need to be, and we become more prone to adopting fundamental philosophies or even theologies of the world, being more steeped in and influenced by our cultures than by God's word, and adopting values and goals and standards and idols that are neither good and pleasing to God nor distinct from the world. God's people need to be more diligently and patiently and lovingly and faithfully taught God's word. And that study of God's word should be deep and comprehensive and purposeful and systematic and devotional. Brothers and sisters, may we be able to say, like the Apostle Paul, that we did not shrink from declaring to the people the whole counsel of God. And that we did not shrink from building them up in the Word of God and defending the sheep from fierce wolves that come in among them, not sparing the flock. And defending them from those among us who arise speaking twisted things to draw away the disciples after them as we are warned in Acts 20. One of the deceptions of false teaching is in using of biblical texts. But distorting and manipulating those texts and manipulating them against the grain of the whole thrust of the Bible's teaching. And in return, our greatest defense against seductions of false teaching is in the arming of all believers with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. So all believers must be more clearly taught, much more deeply taught, much more extensively taught the Word, to be exposed to mind-renewing and life-transforming and heresy-recognizing truth. In other words, to think differently and be less susceptible to false but very attractive teaching. We must know God's Word, and we must know God's mercies as revealed in His Word, mercy received. And then in verses 3 onward, we begin to see how mercy transforms unto radical distinctiveness of the church from the world in biblical living, and radical distinctiveness of the church for the world in biblical mission. We embrace as the Lausanne movement the call to be His people, a people of humility, integrity, and simplicity. And Paul starts right here, doesn't he? He begins his teaching on mercy received, mind renewed, life transformed, radical distinctiveness with the sober and very strong admonition in verse 3. Do not think of yourself more highly than you ought. And then in verse 16, do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. So Paul here is highlighting areas of dangerous conformity to the world. In the advanced paper on this topic before Cape Town, Chris Wright wrote about the idolatry of power and the call to humility. He wrote, "The temptation to seek power and status is very strong. It reflects our fallen nature, since the essence of the fall was to usurp God's authority by exalting our own status over against God." That is also one of the fingerprints of Satan. So it is tragic that so many Christian leaders fall into this sin and exalt themselves. We urgently need to recognize and denounce this for the sin that it is. By contrast, humility is one of the essential marks of Jesus Christ and ought therefore to characterize His followers, especially those who are called to leadership. We join with the Lausanne Covenant with these words of repentance. We confess with shame that we have often denied our calling and failed in our mission by becoming conformed to the world or by withdrawing from it. From this, I think we come to a sober realization that the greatest threat to your ministry is you. John Stott, in his last published sermon, wrote, "The greatest hindrance to the advance of the gospel worldwide is the failure of God's people to live like God's people." The greatest threat to your ministry is you. The greatest threat to global mission is not the lies of the prosperity gospel, nor Islam, nor the lack of funds, nor the lack of missionaries. The greatest threat to global mission is the church. Perhaps we can even say that the greatest threat to the church is her leaders. We pay such sharp attention to the culture wars that are waging around us in society and also waging around the world. But we need to also pay more attention to what is going on inside the church and also inside our hearts. Why are we so surprised when pagans act like pagans? We shouldn't be, but we should be broken and repentant when the church lives like pagans, especially her leaders. I spoke with a Christian friend who talked about how there are two types of global executive Christian leaders. He said the first type, one type is like King Saul. Those who believe that they are God's gift to the global church. Head and shoulders above others and rightly giving the orders for others to follow. And the other type is kind of like young King David, wondering, why me? And wishing his older brothers were chosen for the job, but willing to lead if God is calling. Sadly, he told me that among global executive Christian leaders, it's about half and half. What is the cost of conformity to the pattern of this world? In our ministries and in our own hearts and lives, there is no biblical mission without biblical living. And when we conform to the pattern of this world, we lose integrity, the same integrity that is so essential to the ability to lead the church and witness to the lost. Conformity is the fall of integrity, and this is seen in various contexts and forms within the church. I'd like to briefly talk about just a few of them, in particular, calling us back to sexual integrity, theological integrity, and ministerial integrity. Integrity requires faith and courage. Taking a stand on the gospel, on love, on sin, on sexuality, on morality, on money, on lifestyle, and so many other areas. Three times here in Romans 6, Paul speaks of presenting our bodies or our members to God. And in every case, it is so that our members, our hands and legs and tongues and eyes and ears and our sexual organs would become instruments of righteousness. Verse 13, do not present your members to sin as instruments for unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and your members to God as instruments for righteousness. The Cape Town Commitment comments about how Paul contrasts the purity of God's love with the ugliness of counterfeit love that masquerades in disordered sexuality and all that goes along with it. Disordered sexuality of all kinds in any practice of sexual intimacy before or outside marriage as biblically defined is out of line with God's will and blessing in creation and redemption. The abuse and idolatry that surrounds disordered sexuality contributes to a wider social decline, including the breakdown of marriages and families, and produces incalculable suffering of loneliness and exploitation. It is a serious issue within the church itself, and it is tragically a common cause of leadership failure. The sacrifice that Romans 12 calls for is a holy one, and it is pleasing to God when it is holy. We need to start with a healthy and sober look into our own hearts and lives and repent. That threaten our global witness more than hypocrisy-revealing sexual scandals. There continues to be a regular flow of scandals in the global church. On one side of the world, a preacher fakes a fight with cancer to cover his shame in losing a battle to addiction to pornography. On the other side of the world, a pastor who preached powerfully against homosexual immorality is revealed to have been leading a secret life, having homosexual trysts with a male escort. There are countless quote-unquote successful and quote-unquote blessed ministries rocked by scandals. I can't help but think about the missed opportunities of both of these scandals and scandals like them. What if both leaders had been open and honest with their congregations and ministries and had been the ones to reveal their weaknesses and their sins rather than a television network? What if they had shared such struggles with other leaders and their church leadership early on? What if they had allowed the gospel to heal and cleanse in community and with accountability? What if from the pulpit the message was, I say these things about the dangers of pornography or the darkness of homosexuality because I've been there. I've struggled through these things, and I've seen the power of the gospel to affect change. You know, the difference between having tremendous credibility on a particular subject because of honesty about one's own struggle versus having absolutely no credibility at all for having been caught in public hypocrisy and shame, is in one sense is ever so slight, although they could not be greater in their effects. Winning or losing such heart battles over confession, repentance, and humility is the difference between those who end well and those who do not. Why hypocrisy often wins the day is, I believe, because leaders learn the possibility of being fruitful without being pure. There is, in some sense, the ability to maintain professional administration of ministry, even to see quote-unquote fruitfulness in such activities. This, in turn, can deceive one into thinking that confession of heart struggles and personal sin is in some sense unnecessary and are really mere distractions to ministerial progress. The scary reality is that many seemingly spiritually blessed and fruitful ministries led by morally compromising leaders will never be brought to light on earth. Many lives are successfully lived and many ministries are quote unquote successfully operated apart from true repentance from sin. This is a great scandal of Christian leadership. This is what Christian leaders should fear. And alongside our personal repentance and seeking of personal holiness, we should, as leaders, speak out courageously and compassionately about sexual sin. And we want to speak with humility and love and compassion and with life integrity and biblical integrity and biblical truth. The Cape Town Commitment says that God's design in creation is that marriage is constituted by the committed, faithful relationship between one man and one woman, in which they become one flesh in new social unity that is distinct from their birth families. And that sexual intercourse, as the expression of that one flesh, is to be enjoyed exclusively within the bond of marriage. More and more in our day, this basic biblical teaching is becoming more and more challenged, and more a radical distinction of the church from society and from the world. It is also a temptation for conformity to the world as well. Defending God's design for sexual integrity is critical. This will take increasing amounts of courage to do so. How we defend and celebrate God's design for sexual integrity is critical as well. As the Cape Town Commitment states, we must resist the multiple forms of disordered sexuality in our surrounding cultures, including pornography, adultery, and promiscuity. We must seek to understand and address the deep heart issues of identity and experience which draw some people into homosexual practice, to reach out with the love, compassion, and justice of Christ, and to reject and condemn all forms of hatred, verbal or physical abuse, and victimization of homosexual people. And remember that by God's redemptive grace, no person or situation is beyond the possibility of change and restoration. The temptation for conformity to the patterns of this world and indistinctiveness of the church from the world, whether in pride or sexuality, often will flow from or be aided by the lack or the loss of theological integrity. Test and approve. We must be eager to, we must aspire to be able to test and approve what God's will is. This is a conviction and a calling for Lausanne as a movement as well. Our aspiration as a movement is to be able to play even a very small part in being able to bring global leaders together, to discern together, to test together what God's will might be for global mission. That's what we're doing here this week with all of you. First, there was a discernment process of the 4,000 who gathered in Cape Town. Then there was a discernment process in the formation of the Cape Town Commitment and the identification of 35 core opportunities and challenges for global mission. And now we are convening global consultations like this to address each of these issues, asking for God's guidance to invite the right leaders to have focused time to tackle a critical issue with prayer and hope that God would provide a unified and faithful and strategic and prophetic discernment that can influence and encourage and strengthen the global church in her global mission. So we must test and approve and discern and teach. Theology is critically important. You know, some would say, Don't teach, just love. Don't preach, just serve. Don't give us doctrine, just show us practical faith. But practical faith must have theological foundation to be enduring and to be useful. Doctrine properly understood is immensely practical. There are implications to truth that should impact how we live our lives. Theological integrity matters, and it matters because God's word matters. Lausanne has nothing to say, or at least nothing worth hearing, if it is not grounded in the word of God. So then what Romans 12 beautifully describes is a recognizing of mercy, a consecrating of the whole of ourselves as holy selves, radical distinctiveness and in our nonconformity to the world, transformation by mind renewal, and a testing of the good, pleasing will of God. And I think this recognizing and mind renewal and testing are all a part of theological integrity. And then in verse 9, Paul talks about love. Genuine love, and interestingly, hate as well. Biblical love is neither a hardened love, nor is it too soft. And in order to have power and wisdom in how to exercise that biblical love, there's a critical need for discernment. We need to discern God's good, pleasing, and perfect will. To understand truth, and have our minds renewed in that truth by the Spirit, and then our response to discernment should be enthusiastic. And that's where the strong words of verse 9 come in. As we recognize what is good and pleasing, we are to enthusiastically cling, to embrace, to advocate, to celebrate, to propagate. As we recognize what might not be good or pleasing, then we need to investigate and pray and seek counsel and open our hearts, our own hearts, before God. The two words here, cling and hate, are actually participles in the Greek. So love must be genuine, hating what is evil and clinging to what is good. In other words, biblical love is discriminating. It is not a blind love for any and all things. And if we recognize something as biblically evil, then God's command is to rightly and enthusiastically hate. Recognizing also that anything short of hatred for evil is sin. And recognizing that biblical love is expressed also in biblical hatred. But we do not embrace a self-righteous hatred. Instead, we need to repent of the seeds of the same evil in our own hearts. And also what that hatred is not is responding to evil with evil and revenge rather than with love, as we see in verses 14 to 21. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Repay no one evil for evil, but give thought to what is honorable in the sight of all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. To the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. For by doing so, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So beware of imbalance, either just hating rightly or just loving rightly. Both imbalances are actually dangerous. And beware of unenthusiastically clinging to good or unenthusiastically hating evil. God has neither such imbalance. God is rightly righteous in his hatred of evil. The Bible says that God hates various things, including empty religiosity, Isaiah 1, Amos 5. He hates hypocrisy and lies, Zechariah 8. Divorce and violence, Malachi 2. And there is a just justice that awaits, and a merciful mercy that is offered. God desires for all to come to repentance. There is no conflict in biblical love and biblical hate. There is only conflict in worldly love and worldly hate. Humility, integrity, and lastly, simplicity. Radical distinctions of the church from the world and for the world. When we lack humility, it often leads to compromises in integrity and often bears the fruit of materialism and power. Lausanne has spoken to these issues in the Lausanne Covenant and also in the Lausanne Occasional Paper number 20 on the evangelical commitment to simple lifestyle. I encourage you, for those of you who have interest in this whole debate and topic on simplicity, to read that Lausanne Occasional Paper number 20, and I think you will find a healthy working through of the issue and a balanced perspective as well. Here are some salient quotes. We believe that Jesus still calls some people, and perhaps us, even us, to follow him in a lifestyle of total voluntary poverty. He calls all his followers to an inner freedom from the seduction of riches, for it is impossible to serve God and money, and to sacrificial generosity, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, 1 Timothy 6. Indeed, the motivation and model for Christian generosity are nothing less than the example of Jesus Christ himself, who, though rich, became poor, that through his poverty we might become rich, 2 Corinthians 8. Those who were at the 1980 consultation in England determined to re-examine our income and expenditure in order to manage on less and give away more. We lay down no rules or regulations for either ourselves or others, yet we resolve to renounce waste and oppose extravagance in personal living. We believe that simple living by Christians generally would release considerable resources of financial and of finance and personnel for evangelism as well as development. So by our commitment to a simple lifestyle, we recommit ourselves wholeheartedly to world evangelization. In Romans 12, the call is to offer our whole bodies, our whole selves to God, not merely foot or leg, but our whole selves. And certainly God is not calling us to climb up onto the altar and offer ourselves to him while we first take out our wallets and put our money to the side. Offering our money to God is not the problem of the prosperity gospel. The problem of the prosperity gospel is teaching to give for all the wrong reasons, to get and to earn blessing. The problem, as one Pastor John Onwuchekwa wrote, is that when money and stuff and outward things generally were treated as an indication of God's blessing, they weren't treated as an instrument for blessing others and doing gospel work in terms of his own experience in a prosperity teaching church. So money and health as our measure of God's blessing, rather than as the means for blessing others. You know, some pastors think that their people in their congregation value money too much. I disagree. I think people value money too little. Money is like blood. There is great value and blessing. But money, like blood, was meant to flow through the body like blood, to clean and cleanse and bless and enrich and support and give life. This is God's design for the money that he has blessed us with. We have opportunity for double blessing, to receive and to give. And what a shame it is when we miss out on such fullness of God's blessing in giving. And giving sacrificially and generously for the flow of blood and blessing to the whole body of Christ, to the global body, for the global spread of the gospel. My 8-year-old daughter asked me recently, she said, "Papa, is money important?" And I think Christian parents usually answer like this, "No, baby, money's not important." But kids see that it is. And it's invested very often in unneeded temporal things, things with no eternal value. Money indeed has value, and that value is redeemed eternally when it serves eternal gospel purposes. When we believe God's promises in the gospel, we invest generously in gospel purposes. When we don't believe God's promises, we spend selfishly or hoard fearfully. When we believe we have received a glorious eternal inheritance, we release the ambition to build an earthly inheritance. So again, money is like blood. It was designed to flow. What happens when blood doesn't flow? We die. Our arteries get clogged as we eat and consume, and our hearts get clogged when we see money as ours, not God's, when we sit on our money and count it rather than invest it globally for the gospel. And our hearts get clogged, and the health of our whole lives is in jeopardy. How are we to give? Joyfully, as we all know from 2 Corinthians 9. And also sacrificially. 2 Corinthians 6 says, as poor, yet making many rich, as having nothing, yet possessing all things. How are we to give? Toward our financial poverty, that many might have spiritual wealth. Leaders cannot shy away from talking about money simply from fears about the abuses of prosperity theology. We need to urge biblical generous giving, sacrificial giving, or we too will be in error. We need to have a healthy theology of money. But we must also lead in living with integrity and embrace whatever ways of simplicity and stewardship that the Lord would call you to without imposing our convictions on others and pursuing God's kingdom purposes with passion and humility in view of God's mercy. So in closing, friends, there is a mercy that is to be received and a mercy that is to be enjoyed and a mercy to be studied and a mercy to be taught and a mercy to be lived. Toward what end? We read in Romans 15, 8 through 11, "For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised, to show God's truthfulness, in order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles and sing to your name. And again it is said, rejoice, O Gentiles, with his people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all the peoples extol him. Amen and amen."